All right, hello everyone, and welcome to this online lecture for April 8th of SOC Sociology 377. All right, so in this lecture, I'm going to finish up talking about Jean Twenge's book, iGen, and then move into the final topic of the course, which is a little bit from Jonathan Haidt's book, The Anxious Generation. Okay, so I think this is a really interesting one, and something that Twenge points out that I think is just absolutely fascinating. So basically here we have the percentage of 8th, 10th, and 12th graders who get together with friends every day or nearly every day. And this is from a longitudinal kind of, well, a longitudinal study called Monitoring the Future that's been running since 1976, basically asking young people a whole bunch of questions about their lives. And this is where American research is so good, man. I'm so jealous. Wish we had numbers like this for Canada, but nobody does this kind of research in Canada. Not this long, or you just cannot get funding to do it. So, I mean, for me, the US numbers are really telling. It's obviously a slightly different society, but I think really interesting. But okay, so look at the trend lines, right? And here, you know, we have obviously 12th graders, we have going back to 1976. When we look at, you know, 10th and 8th graders, that only goes back to about 1990, but that's still, you know, 15 years of data, and you see a kind of pretty steady decline. And really right about 2008, so the year after the iPhone comes out, you see it do this sort of sharp drop. Now, sharp drops are really, I mean, it was going down before, but sharp drops are really, really interesting. Really interesting. Because they should not happen, right? Most social phenomena develop very gradually. Very, very gradually. So you would get, like, at the beginning of this graph here, you have the bumpiness. It's kind of trending downwards, up and down, up and down. But not a really sharp, sharp drop that's sustained. Well, lo and behold, the smartphone comes on the scene, and you get this sharp drop amongst all the groups, right? Yikes, something's happening. That's something major, right? A major social shift has happened. And that's the call that Twenge's making in this book. She's like, we have to understand that a major social shift has happened in our young people in particular. Okay, so what does she say? You know, teens are spending less time together than ever before, right? And that's, you know, you see this on Monitoring the Future. College-aged iGeners, right? So there's other data from Monitoring the Future that sort of looks at this. But it's not on this chart. College-age iGeners spend about an hour less a day with friends than millennials did at the same point, you know, and this is as of 2017. Broadly, it's been replaced by screen time and interaction through social media. Now, if the two are equivalent, that's fine. If they aren't, it's a real problem. And I love this quote from Kevin, quoted in the book iGen. People party because they're bored. They want something to do. Now we have Netflix. You can watch series nonstop. And I mean, I think that's true, right? Netflix, and now, like, I mean, now there's Prime, now there's, in Canada, Crave, lots of others, Hulu in the States, Paramount Plus, Disney Plus. I mean, the amount of content that's available to you in your home, at your fingertips, and theoretically things you want to watch, is essentially endless. Like, why would you need to go out, in a sense, right? Why would you need to go out? If everything's at your fingertips. I mean, I don't think it's surprising that, you know, an expression like Netflix and chill for, you know, inviting someone over to watch Netflix for a little bit and then, you know, make out or hook up or whatever it is. By the way, horrifying when I learned what that expression meant, because it did not mean that when Netflix first came out, but okay, it changed meanings. But that can only exist in a world where we're basically staying in is like the norm, right? Where going out with people is not the norm. Where movie theaters struggle to attract people in a lot of cases, you know, even prior to COVID-19, movie theaters were having a tough time because the competition for something like Netflix was enormous and kind of killing the movie industry. Aside from, you know, the Avengers and the Marvel stuff. That stuff makes money. Nothing else does. So I do think interesting. I do think there's obviously something going on here. Screen time has replaced it, and the quantity of things that are available at your fingertips, right? through you've, imagine like video games, interactive games, movies, television shows, an endless panoply of entertainment at your fingertips. So why do you have to go out? You don't have to be bored. And go find your friends to alleviate that boredom. Okay, so doesn't matter, right? As I said before, at least some of that time that's spent on screens is spent on social media, interacting with people. And I've had students tell me this in courses. I remember this particularly in sociology of religion. I remember this student, and I remember it so clearly because it like put me back on my heels a little bit. Talking about religion and the social role of religion, and a student telling me like, "Well, my grandma needs to go to church because that's where she gets her social interaction. But young people don't need it. We have Facebook or social media or whatever. I can't remember the exact wording, but it was pretty close to that." And I was like, "Okay, wow, those two things don't seem at all equivalent to me." And I'll just put it this way, like, when bad stuff happens, this always amuses me watching this on social media. I'm not terribly active, and I have a rule: I never say anything bad that's happened to me on social media. I will tell people personally if I'm having a tough time, but I will never ever post it on social media anymore. I've seen so many times, like somebody has a rough time, like someone dies in their family, or something really horrible happens, and people are like, "Oh my gosh," on Facebook, right? People are like, "Oh my gosh, sending hugs," which might be the most profoundly useless thing in the universe to me. So, and I mean, I would contrast this, I think, broadly with, let's say, religious communities that I've seen in action, right, where people have a baby, people have a death in the family, people, have any financial difficulties, and those communities will actually rally around that person and provide them with weeks, if not months, worth of meals, additional income, try to help them find a job, a good deal more than online hugs. And certainly, like, family members, have helped me out and helped other people out in tough times, right, with financial assistance, food, childcare, all of these things, much more useful than social media hugs, which I find very irritating when people say that for obvious reasons. Okay, so it doesn't matter in person versus online, it really seems to. So this again is basically correlational data that Twenge takes from monitoring the future, and particularly I look at eighth graders. So the relative risk of being unhappy, right? So an absolute risk of being unhappy would be one. A absolute risk, or absolutely no unhappy risk of being unhappy, would be negative one. If you're wondering what this chart kind of means, and if you know how to read a chart like this. Okay, so broadly speaking, right, what do we see? So what we see kind of across this is that most things that are embodied, right, things where you actually go to a place and interact with people or things, tend to be negatively correlated with the risk of being unhappy. Whereas screen time of any kind, broadly, is positively correlated with a risk of being unhappy. Now, the tranche of data here is about 2 years, 2013 to 2015, so it's not a huge tranche of data, but it's pretty revelatory, right? The more, it's time spent on the internet, based on time spent on screens, the more time you spend on the internet, the more likely you are to be unhappy. Social networking websites, right? Basically really high, 0.5, so twice. Like basically 50% more likely to be unhappy. Texting, again, pretty unhappy. Computer games, and video chat, less so a chance of being unhappy. So obviously those media are a little bit different. And then, television, just a slight chance of being unhappy. So what we see, right, is social media, internet, and texting, probably the three major activities of a lot of teenagers, broadly speaking, correlates pretty strongly with relative risk of being unhappy. Okay. So those in-person things where you're interacting with real people or physical objects are very interestingly, right? Sports and ex or exercise. A pretty strong correlation, and generally like anything bigger than 0.2, we see is a very strong correlation. Like something like 0.6 is like an undeniable correlation, but like a 0.2 or a negative 0.2, anything like around or above that would be a pretty strong correlation on the whole. So, physical exercise and sports, really strong correlation with being happy. Religious service attendance, also pretty strong. Interacting with print media, interestingly, as opposed to screens. Good, magazines, books, interesting. Yeah, quite a good correlation. In-person social interaction of any kind, again, pretty good correlation with being happy or with less risk of being unhappy. So I guess more risk, more chance of being happy. And then homework, a slight correlation, not a very strong one. And working, again, a very slight correlation. Right. So that, I mean, I think that's interesting, right? Those who spend more time online were more likely to be unhappy. 56% of those who spent 10 hours a week online said they were unhappy. 47% of those who spend 6 hours a week online said they were unhappy. And all kinds of in-person interaction correlated to greater happiness. And one study that Twenge cites here is a Danish study that looked at, Facebook users. We see that people who use Facebook a lot are more likely to be unhappy. This Danish study involved almost 1,100 individuals, half of whom were asked to stop using Facebook. When they did, those people, a couple weeks later reported being happier. Those who didn't did not. So, with the control group and the experimental group, you saw a bit of a correlation. Broadly speaking, what we see, again, this is a chart, again, monitoring the future, this time from 10th graders. We see the more time spent on social networks, television, internet news, and sadly homework, the more likely people were to say they felt lonely. Now the correlation here isn't super strong, right? It's less than 0.1 for the most part. So it's a fairly weak correlation at the end of the day, but it's there. But you see the really co strong correlation against feeling lonely, in-person social interaction, right, of any kind. Sports and exercise, again, are a pretty strong correlation. Above 0.2, that's looking good. Religious service attendance, a little bit weaker there. Print media use, working, again, social activity like working, so pretty strongly. All right, and kind of as a last point here, iGeners who visit social networks every day are more likely to agree with the statements, "I often feel lonely and I often feel left out of things and I wish I had more good friends." So that's, I mean, kind of sad, right? The more you visit social media, the thing that's supposed to connect you to people, and here's the great irony of it at the end of the day, according to Twenge's work, the more you visit the sites that are meant to connect you to people, the more often you feel left out of things. You wish you had more good friends and you feel lonely. So these apps and these services don't appear to be doing what they promised to do in any real sense. So what are they doing? I mean, I think that's worth asking. I mean, they're commodifying you so that they can sell ads. That is their purpose, right? Facebook is a, and pretty much every social media site is a great ad selling machine. Like mine that says, "You need to buy a hot tub, Jeff." And I would love to buy a hot tub. And I wish Facebook would shut the hell up about it because I can't afford a hot tub. But I click on them just because I'm curious what a hot tub costs. And then I see how much it costs. I'm like, yeah, I can't afford that. So I close it. And then the next day, there's another bunch of hot tub ads. It's very irritating. So for me, I mean, it's just a net loss. But I think the research sort of suggests, if the social media sites are supposed to connect you to people, don't actually make you feel more connected, then what the heck are they doing? Okay, so we know that depressive thoughts, broadly speaking, are kind of related to social media, right? There's a correlation. Younger teens are at a greater risk of social media use correlating to depressive thoughts, and the risk seems to increase with screen time of 2 hours a day or more. Below 2 hours a day actually also has a negative effect, and here it suggests that because of the media environment that young people live in, it's actually sort of necessary to spend at least some time on social media, because otherwise you don't feel connected to people. But beyond 2 hours a day, it gets bad, and below 2 hours a day, it gets bad. So 2 hours is maybe the Goldilocks kind of level. Very high levels of use, 5 hours a day or more is correlated to much higher rates of suicidality. According to Twenge, the rise in reported depression and suicidality or suicidal ideation is not just a reporting thing. Is that there actually is a, because we have fairly good data, especially on suicide attempts, because these things have always been recorded really well. And so she suggests that not only, do we have good recording, a bunch of benchmark studies that have been running for decades, right? Things like monitoring the future, the Youth Risk Behavior Surveillance System, and a bunch of other actually fairly longitudinally, like cross-sectional, but long-term cross-sectional studies have noted, increasing signs of depressive symptoms in young people, and they go back, some of them to the 60s. So we have a pretty good idea of what's going on. Yeah, monitoring the future, youth risk behavior studies, the college entry study, all of these things are kind of long-term studies that Ray thinks, God, I love American data. Really do. They do such a good job. Okay, so yeah, about 46% or more of 15 to 19-year-old, or 46% more 15 to 19-year-olds committed suicide in 2015 than in 20, 2007. So that is a lot. That is a lot, obviously. A big rise and a sharp rise, right? If you put that on a chart, it'd be a hockey stick. Hockey stick graphs are generally signs of big social change. 2.5 times more 12 to 14-year-olds committed suicide. And what's interesting is that youth suicide in particular used to be an almost exclusively male phenomenon. Not 100%, obviously, but a very, like, the gender differences between males and females was pronounced in terms of suicide. Men are much more likely to commit suicide in general. Now we've seen a sharp rise in girls attempting suicide and committing suicide. Really, and again, the start date for this is somewhere in the mid-2000s. So again, correlation doesn't equal causation always, but such strong correlation should be paid attention to, I think. Okay, so cyberbullying is another kind of obviously thing that really takes off with social media. Right, prior to kind of vectors for cyberbullying, it would have been difficult to cyberbully someone. Like, you could email them, I suppose, but it's not pervasive in the same way as cyberbullying is now. And cyberbullying really does differ from bullying in the past, primarily because of its pervasiveness and inescapability. Right? It used to be that, if you were being bullied at school, you went home and your home was the sanctum sanctorum, right? The safe place where you were unlikely to continue being bullied at home. You had a break. And not to say that the experience of being bullied was awesome. Far from it. Of course not. But it wasn't pervasive. You had a break from it. And now that's not the case, right? People will create fake accounts, target people on social media, especially things like Instagram, make negative comments, especially about female bodies. A lot. Telling people to kill themselves, like, these are not funny things. These are horrible things. And it's pretty pervasive, right? And what happens, obviously, and again, I don't need to tell you this, but I think you all know, is it's a ping of your phone. People are talking about you behind your back on social media. You get kind of a ping on your phone. And it's really, really ugly. So 66% of those of cyberbullied teens have at least one suicide risk factor. Two-thirds have one suicide risk factor. That's only compared to only 9% of those who are bullied in school. That constancy seems to make a difference, right? That the fact that there is no safe place from social media bullying. Social rejection, even online, has powerful effects psychologically. We're wired as creatures to really fear social rejection. And this obviously has to do with the kind of nature of the human race, right? When we were living in nature, essentially, before we constructed societies that could protect us from nature, we were at real risk if we were out alone. We're not the most terrifying creature, right? We don't have good claws or teeth or anything to help us protect ourselves. The lions and the tigers, they will eat us very rapidly if we are out there on our own. our big protection has always been the group. And so we're wired evolutionarily to fear social rejection. Now we can be socially rejected hundreds, thousands of times a day online and know that we're excluded from the group. And that does strange things to a cognitive system that is still essentially wired, you know, for the forests of Europe or the African savanna or the plains of North America or the jungles of East Asia, right, where you had to stay in your group or you were in danger. Because predators and other things would try to kill you. Our brains are not wired to deal with that much rejection. Okay, so how does this work, right? One example is on Instagram, right? And this I'm taking from an article from Time Magazine, The Secret Language of Girls on Instagram. So there's, you know, public measures of popularity, right? You can announce to people that you've taken a photo of them and with them by tagging them in a new photo, which announces it on their app. And sometimes people do one better, right? They take a photo where the person is not present and then tag the person and add gushy, lovey comments, you know, commenting on, you know, how they wish their BFF was there or whatever. And how many photos you're tagged in is important, apparently. Says Charlotte 12, no one can actually see the number. But you can sort of just tell because you see the name popping up over and over again. It can be used to show, you know, your bestie a PDA. Nobody gives, I guess, a heart best friend heart necklace. Actually, my daughter's given two of these out, but that's okay. Now girls use Instagram biographies, you know, a few lines at the top of their page to trumpet their inner circle. And I've certainly seen this with children of some friends of mine, you know, doing that kind of stuff. And then a way to retaliate, right? You can crop people out of pictures, refuse to follow them back, block them, you know, actually remove tags from images they were in, or, you know, post images of a party a friend wasn't invited to, or an intimate, you know, sleep overnight or whatever, just to kind of point out what they're missing. Couldn't very well exit this course without one last Cobra Kai reference. You know, as I'm getting ready to crack open my Coors Banquet to celebrate the end of this course, I wanted to throw in one last moment. And so here I've got a clip of an example of cyberbullying on Cobra Kai, and then a slightly longer section where, Sensei Johnny Lawrence, straight out of the 80s, lays it out how it is of how, you know, he thinks cyberbullying should be dealt with.
My student tells me you've been harassed at school.
Yeah, mostly online. I get mean texts and emails sent to me. Makes me not want to go.
And who sends you these messages?
Well, they're mostly anonymous. These kids create fake accounts. And they tell me things like I'm ugly and that I should kill myself.
Pussies. Back in my day, if you wanted to tease someone, you did it to their face. It was honor, respect. These geeks hiding behind their computers, what a bunch of spineless losers. You're not afraid of these losers, are you?
No.
Are you gonna take shit from these losers?
No.
Good, because when I'm done with you, you're gonna be sending a message back. Only it's not gonna be with your keyboard. It's gonna be with your fists.
Okay, Okay, so two kind of competing graphs here, and I think interesting, a little bit heartbreaking to an extent, right? Troubling, I think, in lots of ways. So, here we have the percentage of 12th graders who are satisfied with their lives as a whole and with themselves. And we see, right, it had been actually rising pretty steadily up until, around 2012, that year that half of all Americans owned a smartphone. And then it just drops like a rock. Now, it's a short sample size, right? It's a short sample size. And really, the levels have only fallen back to about where they were in 1976. So it's not the end of the world necessarily, but I mean, there's obviously a sharp change because something kind of drops down and it had been kind of bumping up before. So something weird. And then, same thing with this other graph, figure 4.3. Percentage of 8th, 10th, and 12th graders who mostly agree or agree that they often feel left out of things, and a lot of times they feel lonely, right? You look at around 2010, 2012, that number starts to rise really sharply, and actually goes up to levels, never seen before in either of those figures, right? It goes way back above, where it was, in 19 or 1991. So, I mean, this is concerning, right? Again, these numbers are not necessarily the end of the world, but definitely concerning. Okay, so yeah, girls seem much more vulnerable than boys to some of the negative effects of social media. Selfies in particular open them up to body shaming and lots of comments from anonymous sites like Aisha, telling them they're ugly or they're fat or whatever. Sexy pictures, and there's a depressing number of these posted by very, very young people. Often people following trends set by influencers like Kim Kardashian or others, but it opens them up to slut shaming and, obviously comments on their appearance. And, again, if you want to go back and look at American Girls by Nancy Jo Sales, she has just a catalog of some of the nasty things people say, about, every aspect, faces, breasts, posteriors, all of them not living up to some standard that someone has, and they feel like they can comment on it. It's in obviously strangers or anonymous accounts. Okay, so depressed teens far more likely to self-injure, and this is I thought was an interesting quote from Fadi Haddad, a psychiatrist at Bellevue Hospital in New York City, saying, every single week she sees girls come into the ER after some social media rumor or incident upset her and she harmed herself. Most of them involve just cutting, chest cutting. Cutting's still really serious, obviously cutting. Physical self-harm as a way to cope with emotions, but some of them are getting more serious. And between 2011 and 2016, 30% more college students said they intentionally injured themselves, often to cope with emotional difficulties. Okay, so one of the kind of final things that I do want to talk about here is the way that smartphones and social media tend to steal sleep. So teens, girls though in particular, are sleeping less, and the culprit seems to be the smartphone, right? Teens are staying up and staying connected till later at night, often, with pings on social media waking them up to check their phones. So roughly 50% more teens were sleep deprived in 2015 than in 1991, as self-reported. 22% more teens failed to get 7 hours of sleep in 2015 as opposed to 2012. And it's just, some of it's been blamed on blue light, but that doesn't seem to be the whole thing. Is that people are actually staying up, to watch videos, but principally on social media, and teenagers especially messaging with each other all night and getting alerts when someone's tagged something, they're asleep and then their phone goes bang and awake they are again. So I guess, the question is, could it be something else, right? This is all a lot of correlative evidence, and I think the bulk of it redounds to the smartphone. But Twenge doesn't think so either, right? Twenge really doesn't think it could be anything other than smartphones and social media, right? Factors would have to emerge or change about the same time as the rise of the smartphone and social media, for it to cause this kind of rise in depression and suicidality, right? There has to be some factor changing things. And the correlation between smartphones and social media is just too neat, right? It fits the timeline too well. Right, so three things change in a way correlated with declines in mental health, right? Screen time increases among teens, especially use of smartphones and social media. And we've seen these are all linked to poor mental health outcomes. Rates of in-person social interaction, which is good for you, decline. Those things are linked to greater happiness and positive mental health outcomes. And the use of print media declines, right? Also linked, use of print media linked to less unhappiness and depression. So Twenge doesn't really think it could be anything else at the end of the day. So what is her advice then? Well, basically it is to sort of live like a caveman, right? What is good for you? Sunlight. Sunlight is really important for people. It makes you feel better. It generates vitamin D, which reduces depressive symptoms and increases your immune system. In-person contact. And I think, you know, I think now we don't need anyone to tell us this. I think we've all learned. And sleep. Sleep is really important, right? Our bodies are designed to go to sleep at night when it's dark, but now we can create artificial light and stay awake all night. All of these are the things that our ancient ancestors did, right? They're the things that our bodies evolved to do. So our bodies and minds still seem to need all of these things, even if we've created societies where it's increasingly hard to get them or we can get around them. So her advice is go outside, exercise, see people, and sleep at night. Put your smartphone in the kitchen, not at your bedside, buy an alarm clock. That's it. Super easy, barely an inconvenience. All right, I got a cutesy little video to end off here. And then one final thing, and then the course is done.
I have 422 friends, yet I'm lonely. I speak to all of them every day, yet none of them really know me. The problem I have sits in the spaces between, looking into their eyes or at a name on a screen. I took a step back and opened my eyes. I looked around and realised that this media we call social is anything but when we open our computers and it's our doors we shut. All this technology we have, it's just an illusion. Community, companionship, a sense of inclusion. Yet when you step away from this device of delusion, you awaken to see a world of confusion. A world where we're slaves to the technology we mastered, where information gets sold by some rich, greedy bastard. A world of self-interest, self-image, self-promotion, where we all share our best bits but leave out the emotion. We're at our most happy with an experience we share, but is it the same if no one is there? Be there for your friends and they'll be there too, but no one will be if a group message will do. We edit and exaggerate, crave adulation. We pretend not to notice the social isolation. We put our words into order until our lives are glistening. We don't even know if anyone is listening. Being alone isn't the problem. Let me just emphasize, if you read a book, paint a picture, or do some exercise, you're being productive and present, not reserved and recluse. You're being awake and attentive and putting your time to good use. So when you're in public and you start to feel alone, put your hands behind your head, step away from the phone. You don't need to stare at your menu or at your contact list. Just talk to one another, learn to coexist. I can't stand to hear the silence of a busy commuter train where no one wants to talk through the fear of looking insane. We're becoming unsocial. It no longer satisfies to engage with one another and look into someone's eyes. We're surrounded by children who, since they were born, have watched us living like robots and think it's the norm. It's not very likely you'll make world's greatest dad if you can't entertain a child without using an iPad. When I was a child, I'd never be home. Be out with my friends on our bikes we would roam. I'd wear holes in my trainers and graze up my knees. We'd build our own clubhouse high up in the trees. Now the park's so quiet it gives me a chill. See no children outside and the swings hanging still. There's no skipping, no hopscotch, no church and no steeple. We're a generation of idiots, smartphones and dumb people. So look up from your phone, shut down the display. Take in your surroundings, make the most of today. Just one real connection is all it can take to show you the difference that being there can make. Be there in the moment that she gives you the look that you remember forever as when love overtook. The time she first holds your hand or first kiss your lips. The time you first disagree but still love her to bits. The time you don't have to tell hundreds of what you've just done because you want to share this moment with just this one. the time you'll sell your computer so you can buy a ring for the girl of your dreams who is now the real thing, the time you want to start a family, and the moment when you first hold your little girl and get to fall in love again. The time she keeps you up at night and all you want is rest, and the time you wipe away the tears as your baby flees the nest. The time your baby girl returns with a boy for you to hold, and the time he calls you granddad and makes you feel real old. The time you take in all you've made just by giving life attention, and how you're glad you didn't waste it by looking down at some invention. The time you hold your wife's hand, sit down beside her bed, you tell her that you love her, lay a kiss upon her head. She then whispers to you quietly, as her heart gives a final beat, that she's lucky she got stopped by that lost boy in the street. But none of these times ever happened. You never had any of this. When you're too busy looking down, you don't see the chances you miss. So look up from your phone, shut down those displays. We have a finite existence, a set number of days. Don't waste your life getting caught in the net, as when the end comes, nothing's worse than regret. I am guilty too of being part of this machine, this digital world we are heard but not seen, where we type as we talk and we read as we chat, where we spend hours together without making eye contact. So don't give in to a life where you follow the hype. Give people your love, don't give them your like. Disconnect from the need to be heard and defined. Go out into the world, leave distractions behind. Look up from your phone, shut down that display. Stop watching this video, live life the real way.
Alright, so here we're going to transition to Haidt's book, The Anxious Generation. And The Anxious Generation, in a way, is kind of a follow-up to iGen. It's the same thesis, and I will say Jonathan Haidt and Gene Twenge are friends, and they have collaborated on this book and on Jonathan's Substack, which is After Babel. It's really good. It's free. You should go subscribe to it if this topic interests you. So, one of the things that Jonathan is really on about in the book is the harm caused by smartphones. Right, and again, this has been contested. You know, there definitely have been accounts of Twenge's work that are critical, particularly that accuse her of missing the point that correlation and causation are not the same thing. Just because the rise in smartphones happens to happen at the same time as the rise in anxiety in Gen Z doesn't mean that the smartphone is the cause, right? And this is fair enough. But I think Jonathan and Gene have done a good job of defending themselves against that particular accusation, showing that actually, there's nothing else it could be, right? If this is the sort of, Sherlock Holmes principle that if you eliminate the impossible, whatever remains, however improbable, must be the truth. And so once you've eliminated all other possible causes, and people have posited that it's the economic crash of 2008 that ultimately has led Gen Z to be anxious, or police violence, or COVID. But it doesn't seem to be any of these things, because all of these things in some way, the timing doesn't fit, right? Gen Z, millennials and Gen Z are doing fine mental health terms well past the 2008 recession. And it isn't until, we hit kind of 2010, 2014 that we hit to the decline. So let's take a look a little bit at the start of Jonathan's argument. Okay, so again, kind of like, with Twenge, because the acceleration in declining or poor mental health outcomes accelerated so quickly, the assumption is, and I think this assumption ultimately makes a ton of sense, that has to be caused by something relatively recent in the environment. This change seems to have start between 2010 and 2014. We look at most of the data and most of the different places around the world. And so this has led Twenge and Haidt to argue that the change has to do with the introduction of smartphones and social media and the conjunction of the two technologies, which I think is really important, right? It is the fact that you access social media on these smartphones, which you have with you all the time, which makes social media pervasive. And yeah, smartphone ownership among teens jumped according to Height from 23% in 2011 to 79% in 2016, right? So from less than a quarter to over three quarters in just a few years, which is a big, big change. Okay, a 2015 report cited by Height from Common Sense Media, which is a nonprofit group that looks at, you know, all sorts of things, movie reviews, you know, kind of thinking, helping parents think through what media habits are good for their kids. And Common Sense found that teens with a social media account spend an average of 2 hours a day online. A Pew Research report, right, found that in 2015, a quarter of teens said they were online almost constantly. So that's 2015. By 2022, it had nearly doubled to 46%. Yeah, and I mean, this is something that I think, this last point is something that Sherry Turkle has talked about in her book Alone Together, and in Reclaiming Conversation and a lot of her work. What she says is that, for those that are constantly online, even when they're in person, they're thinking about somewhere else, right? They're never really fully present in a lot of ways. So as I said last class, 2010 was a particularly, I guess, important year. In June of 2010, the iPhone 4 launches and has a front-facing camera. So the way that the iPhone went in terms of its generations is they're kind of weird. You know, it went the iPhone 3G, the iPhone 3GS, and then the iPhone 4. So the iPhone 4 was the fourth generation of the iPhone, and the first one, actually, it was a major redesign of the device, and the first one to come with a front-facing camera. And apparently this was, you know, convergent evolution of technologies, because Samsung launched its first Galaxy phone, the Galaxy S, also with a front-facing camera. So the two major smartphone platforms now had front-facing cameras on their flagship devices. Same year, right? In the same year, Instagram launched in 2012, it sold to Facebook, right? And it grows from a user base of about 10 million to 90 million by the end of 2013. So it grows really, really quickly. And the selfie becomes a major social media tool, right? So basically, teen girls in large part start engaging on Instagram. Boys are playing video games. They're on YouTube, they're on Reddit, and they're engaged with hardcore internet porn. So by 2012, certainly by 2013, things have changed in major ways for young people. And these social media platforms have really, really taken over. Okay, so one of the things that Height really stresses is what he calls the great rewiring, right? And it is essentially trying to contrast sort of two modes of being. One you could think of as the traditional mode, right? The one that human beings have lived, you know, since the dawn of the species, you know, since it evolved from its mammalian roots, its roots in the primate, other primates. And we share still a lot of traits with mammals. One of these is that we are wired for play when we're young, right? Mammals learn a ton by play. So if you ever had a kitten, right, and a kitten is jumping at a piece of twine, right, that's on the ground or, you know, a piece of yarn, you know, it's pouncing, it's clumsy, it falls down, it misses, right? This is how cats learn to hunt, right? And this is something, you know, that when you see animals out in nature playing, you know, two young foxes or young wolves playing, you know, fighting, they're learning the things that they need to master in order to become successful adults, right? If they don't master those things, they won't be able to find food, they won't be able to protect themselves, they'll die. So
What's interesting is, you know, in circumstances where they're either isolated or for whatever reason they aren't allowed to play, most mammalian species, right, rats and primates and wolves and humans, right, come out socially, cognitively, and emotionally impaired. Play is incredibly important for mammalian species in proper emotional development. And this is interesting, and you know, you can tell, you know, if you ever get in trouble for gossiping, right, your partner tells you not to gossip, or your mother scolds you for gossiping, you know, you can say, well, you know, gossiping is actually an important part of learning to navigate social environments, Mom, so, you know, get off my back, right? Joking, teasing, gossiping, you know, for human beings, not obviously for animals, gives us lessons in nuance and nonverbal cues that are keys to social skills, right? To developing proper social skills as adults, we need all of those things. And play with others, what Haidt will stress, is that play with others, you know, adults and other children, introduces some degree of risk. Some degree of risk, and teaches children how not to get hurt, right? What might hurt you and what might not hurt you. And yeah, in this type of play, there's risks. You know, in the play that mammals and especially humans undergo, there's risks, but typically these risks are not very costly, right? The risk is a scraped knee, the broken bone, right? You know, hurt feelings, a ball in the face, right? These are all things that can happen when young people play, but it's not very costly. So one of the things that Haidt stresses is that this type of play is embodied, right? So you're there with your body. It's synchronous. It happens in real time. It's one-to-one or one-to-several. However, what he'll stress is that the alternative and the thing that we've rewired young people for, which he calls phone-based childhood, is none of those things, right? It's disembodied, asynchronous, and one-to-many. Okay, so phone-based childhood, you know, obviously, and we see this chart right on the one side, this is meetups with friends daily, you know, for boys and girls, how often they meet up with friends, right? And this is, I think this is data from Monitoring the Future, which is a, you know, that big poll that Twenge talks about all the time. And so we see, again, you know, the percentage of young people meeting up with friends daily has been going down since the early 90s. So what Haidt says is that phones and other screens are experience blockers. They open new types of experiences, but every single minute you spend on a phone screen is a moment not spent in the real world. Okay, and life online for young people stresses a bunch of things, right? Again, with the image-based thing that we talked about a little bit with girls, you have to be a brand manager, right? Youth are brand managers on the internet. Internet culture has permanence, right? Once you do something online, it is really, really hard to escape from the things that you have done. So you have to think ahead of the consequences of what you're doing, which is sort of anxiety-inducing, right? Think about the difference between, like, playing soccer with your friends. You don't really have to think about the long-term consequences. Okay, if you get in a fight with Timmy, right, about a goal that you think wasn't a goal, or you think they tripped you, and you wanna, you know, and you get into a fight, you punch each other. There's no real long-term consequences of that. That's gonna get resolved within the friend group or maybe by an adult, right? Each of you will apologize and move on. You don't really have to think about the long-term consequences. Whereas online, you know, if you make that post, is someone going to make fun of you in the future? Is an employer going to see it 5 years down the road? Is someone going to dredge it up when you go to apply for university or college and get your scholarship taken away? And I say these are all things that have happened to people. Okay, and yeah, I mean, there's just a sharp decline in time spent with friends as phones become more normalized. And Haidt will say, and I'll end with this, that phones also block a function called attunement, which is where we tune in to other people, especially when we're younger children, but all through kind of our life. You know, we imitate, we read people, we're always reading reactions, right? We're attuned to the reactions of people. And phones blunt this, right? Because if you're distracted by your phone, right, you're listening to a song in your headphone, or you're on your screen and you're not paying attention to your baby or your kid, right, we're less attuned to them and they're less attuned to us. And yeah, you know, we spend less synchronous time together than we did in the past, you know, things like dancing together, singing the same songs, and there are less common experiences because now everyone has this curated experience all to themselves. All right, we'll leave it there for today, and we'll see you in class on Wednesday, where we'll continue talking about Jonathan Haidt's book.